I believe
era nzikiriza
that one of the spiritual gifts we possess.
Let's talk about you starting the Covenant Nations Church. From all we know, you are a pastor at this church and you're the founding pastor. What inspired you to actually start this church, and how is the church faring currently?
Well, if you read the book, I think you will see the journey. It was really an unexpected life, I think. I had my own plan. I had my own trajectory that I was seeing myself going on. Like everybody has, you think you're going to finish school, you're going to do this and that, you have the direction you're going in. And so walking with God is really a walk of faith, and trusting Him and hearing His voice and following His leading. So really it's God. It's God who kept leading me on this journey and diverting me in what I thought was diverting, but actually now with hindsight, it was the original plan. It was me who didn't know that this was His plan. But there would always be that taking a different turn than I had expected. And as a Christian, you struggle with that because there's a struggle of, are you going to obey God's voice or are you going to go your own way? And so, yeah, so that was, I think, the struggle. But it was God, what I'm trying to say. It was God's plan all along. It was not my plan. I think I would have thought I would be an astronaut before I would be a preacher of the gospel, simply because of the responsibility. So it's a weighty responsibility. It's not something you take lightly to say, you know, thus says the Lord. It's not something that you just wake up and do. So it was, I never ever thought that that was something that, so it was a complete surprise even to me. Yeah. I always was hoping, I think that's what I share, it's something I share in the book. I thought that it was a temporary thing. I thought God wanted me to do something temporarily, and then someone else would come who is more qualified, in quotes, to do the work. So I thought, oh, maybe God wants me to do this for a year, maybe 2 years max, and then somebody else will come who is the actual person. And so that's how I started it. And God always, I think, gives you enough grace for just like the day, the moment. He doesn't show you that, no, actually, this is the long-term plan. So I started with that thinking, oh, okay, I'll do this, but it's not going to stop me from doing other things. I will continue doing my own things. But as I continued walking with God, and the ministry now started becoming its own, you know, thing, and God kept on showing me that, no, this is actually what I want you to do. And I give an example. I don't know if I give an example in the book of Luke. Luke in the Bible, who's known as the physician, the beloved physician. Luke is the one who wrote the Gospel of Luke and also the book of Acts. And Luke was a physician. And I'm sure this writing of the book of Acts and the book of Luke was probably something he did on the side. Maybe he was just a methodical person who likes to know history and write, and his main work was, he was a physician. But the Gospel of Luke and the Book of Acts is probably the most seminal work that he ever did. So God has a way of really showing you that what you have been preparing for is the most unexpected thing, and to be obedient to that, and to show, and to allow God's plan to overshadow your own plan. Yeah, that's, I think, the struggle. Well, I don't think that I chose the path. I think the path chose me. I don't think I said, "Oh, I want to be a pastor." I said, "This is what I feel God is telling me to do." And because my family knew my relationship with God, and they knew that I wouldn't just wake up and say, God is telling me to do something, if really God was not telling me to do something. So there was that support, always that support of trying to help, you know, in whatever way they could. I think it has evolved over time because you see, in the beginning, it was not really, for me, myself, it wasn't even clear. Is this permanent? Is this... So I think for my family, it was always just to support me, you know, as best they could, as the Lord was also leading them, you know, if you can help with this, can help. In the beginning, my siblings helped a lot with, you know, like children's church or worship or, you know, or even elders and things like that. So they always tried to support. My mom also, you know, has always supported with prayer and with advice. She gave me advice, a lot of advice. So everyone tried to help in the way that they could. You know. Well, the first home of the church was our home, and not here. We had we have another place here in Buziga, but so that was the first home of the church in 2006, and it was in our home for 3 years. So then after that, we moved to another rented space because there was now there were more people and we couldn't keep everyone in our compound and all that. So we moved to another space and then another space. So we had that space in Luzira. We had that property. And when we needed now to have a more permanent place, we had bought a land for the church outside of town, but we were not yet ready to build a permanent, you know, home there. So we decided to renovate a space. There were warehouses in Luzira, so we took one of the warehouses and renovated them. And so that became now the space that the...
Well, you talked about hearing God's voice to get into this work of being a pastor. But just allow me to be curious, because you also talk about at the age of 11, having started, you know, getting more close to God, reading your Bible, and then, you know, hearing that voice that called you into this work as a pastor. So I'm just curious. I want to know, like any other person, this voice, I'm wondering, could it have been the things that you read in the Bible that stayed in your mind that actually, you know, turned out to be the voice that you say you had that called you into this work as a pastor?
Well, as I share in the book, I started hearing from God when I was young. I think around 11, I think that was the first time that I heard distinctly a voice which is not my voice and not somebody else's voice. Not an audible voice, but a voice that is very clear that you can hear. I started it's like a conversation, like how we're having a conversation now, like you become more adept at recognizing the voice because you just continue a conversation. Then when I gave my life to the Lord, I would, you know, spend a lot of time reading the Bible. And then the voice that you hear is similar to the voice in the Bible. It's not different. It's really the same voice. So it grew stronger, I think, because of the knowledge of the Word of God and then prayer and just the continue. It's a relationship, really. It's like, how do you get to know someone? You get to know them by being in the relationship. You know that you get to know what makes them happy, what makes them sad, what makes them, you get to know more about the person by being in the relationship. So even with God, you get to know God more by just this walk, the daily walk. So yeah, so hearing his voice, I used to think that everybody hears, I thought he was just normal. And it was later on when I would always, you know, talk to people and say, well, why don't you just ask God? He will tell you. And I would understand that, you know, maybe everyone doesn't talk to God in the same way, but I believe that it's open to every believer. I don't think that there is any, God doesn't show partiality. There's no, you know, this is for this or this is for that. But I think that it's open to every believer to be able to hear from God. because Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice, and the voice of a stranger they don't follow. So I believe that every believer can hear from God, but it is a lifetime of relationship, really. In the book, I share the story of how it's a bit of a lengthy story, but I started seeing this vision. I think it was around 2005, 2006, started seeing a vision. And it was a vision of Africa, and it was showing a light coming out of Uganda and going out to Africa. And I kept on seeing that same vision, and I didn't know what it meant. And I would ask God, and it just kept on recurring over a course of a year. So I kept praying about it, and at some point, you know, to cut the long story short, the Lord revealed to me that light that was coming out of Uganda was His word, was the word of God, and how Uganda really had a redemptive purpose, a special redemptive purpose, and as Uganda aligned with that redemptive purpose, it would have an effect on other nations in the region. And so it was all very vague, as in it wasn't clear, what does that mean? What does the light mean? And so it was only when the Lord really challenged me about obedience and about following Him and about really being open to the way he wanted me to obey Him, that he revealed to me that it was a church, and that was the way that He wanted me to obey Him was through the planting of the church, which was very, very, I share in the book, it was very, very shocking, because I had never really been in church. I had been in relationship with Jesus, but not really in church, involved deeply in church. And so it was out of left field. So yeah, but it was again that revelation, that sort of revealing of God's will. Down at the cross where my Savior.